Welcome back, everyone. I want to continue with my discussion of the different types of dip slip faults. Our last fault we will talk about is a strike slip fault. Shear stress is the stress involved with a strike slip fault. And so the rocks simply slide past one another. We can differentiate between two strike slip faults. We have right lateral and left lateral. The way you can tell if you have a right or a left lateral is you stand and face the fault. You look across the fault, and the direction that that block moves, whether it be right or left, tells you if it's a right or left lateral strike slip fault. Here's an image. You can see the shear stress. So these two blocks are sliding past each other. So right or left lateral. You stand on one side of the fault, you look across to the other side. Do the streams appear to have been shifted right or left? Hopefully you say right. So we would say that this is a right lateral strike slip fault. The San Andreas shown in this bottom picture is a right lateral strike slip fault. Large strike slip faults that actually cut through continental crusts due to tectonic plate motion are called transform faults. And the San Andreas fault is a strike slip fault that is part of a transform fault. Normal faults, reverse faults, strike slip faults, those are grouped together and called dip slip faults. We can also have oblique slip faults that have not only strike slip, but dip slip movement as well. And that becomes a bit more complex in nature. When fault blocks move, large earthquakes can be generated. Some very large earthquakes related to strike slip faults have occurred in the recent past, Haiti in 2010, for example. Even larger earthquakes are associated with subduction zones, what we call megathrust faults. Japan in 2011 that generated a large tsunami, and Sumatra in 2004 that also generated a very large tsunami, killing a couple hundred thousand people. This image shows the destruction in Haiti in 2010. And once again, this was a strike slip fault. When blocks drop and one block gets down faulted and the other up faulted, what develops is a feature called a fault scarp. And it is an elevated cliff. With time, these fault scarps can be eroded away. Here, this person is measuring the up faulted block. On some fault surfaces, due to movement of the blocks, the rocks can become polished and grooved. We call these slick insides. The next rock structure I want to talk about due to brittle deformation are joints. These are simply fractures in the rock where no appreciable movement has occurred. Oftentimes, joints occur in parallel groups. This image here is showing the parallel groups of joints. So this is brittle behavior again. The structural geologist will map different geologic structures. This is accomplished by looking at outcrops of exposed bedrock. Today, we also have assistance from aerial photography, satellite imaging, GPS, and seismic reflection profiling. I mentioned strike and dip in the previous video. Let's go into a little bit more detail of what this is. Oftentimes, it's difficult for students to grasp this concept. So sedimentary rocks that are inclined or bent indicate deformation after deposition. We can then measure the strike. That is the compass bearing of the line that is produced by the intersection of the inclined rock layer or fault with the horizontal plane. And once again, we report it as north so many degrees east or north so many degrees west. We use a device called a Brunton compass to measure the strikes and dips of rock layers or sedimentary structures. If a rock layer is not horizontal with the Earth's surface, then we refer to it as having a dip. And strike and dip, once again, are always 90 degrees to each other. Our Brunton compass can measure the dip of a rock layer. Looking at this picture again, I oftentimes find it easier to determine the dip direction before the strike. If you were to pour water down this rock layer, it would roll in this direction. That tells you the dip direction. If I know dip, then I know strike is always 90 degrees from dip. So here's our rock layers. Let's look at this purple layer here. So we can see clearly that the horizontal would be here, and then it's dipping down 30 degrees. They've measured it. Now, strike then is 90 degrees from that. And so in this case, once measured, it's north 42 degrees east. This surface here shows the horizontal plane, and it's the intersection of the horizontal plane and this line here that is our line of strike. It is the trend of the rock. So pretend you are a geologist and you get dumped out in the field to study some rock layers. This is what you view as you walk across an area at the Earth's surface. We look at the top of this block diagram that shows what's going on at the Earth's surface. And you go and you take measurements of these rock layers. You take their strike and dip. And these are the values that you determine. You can then go back to the lab and create a picture of what's going on underground based on your strikes and dips that were measured at the surface. Once you do this, you can plot and then get a nice picture of what's going on underground. So we can see this yellow layer here is striking pretty much north-south, if we assume north is up on this map, which we will, and it is dipping due west. So, actually it's dipping 40 degrees west. So we draw our strike of our bed here, and then we measure 40 degrees down, and that bed is dipping 40 degrees towards the west. On the other side, the rock unit, same rock unit, but it's dipping at a steeper angle, 76 degrees. And so we would draw that limb at a steeper angle than this one, which is only 40 degrees. And you continue plotting and drawing under, and then you can connect the rock layers. So this used to be a feature called, what type of geologic structure that involved ductal deformation and up warping and down warping? This is an anticline, this is a syncline. Are they plunging or non-plunging? Remember, look at the top of the map. If you see that U or V-shaped pattern on the top, it tells you it's plunging. If they're relatively straight lines, then it is a non-plunging fold. This example is showing a non-plunging anticline and syncline. Youngest rocks in the middle in a syncline, oldest rocks in the middle for an anticline. So you can see how mapping an area can give you a view of what is going on underground. That concludes our Chapter 10 video series on crustal deformation. Our next unit will be on earthquakes.